And good morning to you. And of course, thanks for joining us on The Breakfast here on PLOS TV Africa. It's a very beautiful Friday morning, public holiday across Nigeria, because we're celebrating Nigeria's 61st Independence Day. And of course, we're going to be having loads of these conversations this morning for everyone who got to watch the president address the country this morning from 7 a.m. Pretty interesting speech.
Indeed. Good morning to you. Welcome again to The Breakfast. My name is Annetta Felix. Looking forward to really unbundling the president's speech. We just listened to that really lengthy, covered just about every aspect of our society. We have been clamoring for the president to speak, and he has spoken on key issues that affect all of us. And I think I want us to begin from the bottom, right? He mentioned one of his final speeches, this was in his 100th point, that no government since 1999 has done what the Buhari administration has done in 6 years to put Nigeria back on track. Looking forward to getting our guests to really analyze this statement, because even though there are definitely lots of high points of the Buhari administration, but lots of people argue that there has to be a balance to that conversation, which means bringing to the table all the negatives, really, that have occurred while Buhari has been in power in the past 6 years. So him making that assertion to say that no government has ever done what he's done in the past 6 years, since 1999, really would be a subject of debates, really, when the conversation starts proper, don't you think?
I don't expect, you know, the president to go on live television and say that they failed. So, you know, it's expected that he will make those type of statements, comparing, you know, what Nigeria achieved between 1999 and 2015. And in the last 6 years, there's a lot of people who would argue, you know, that, of course, we've basically gone 50 years back in the last 6 years. And of course, so you just mentioned that there's a lots and lots of achievements. You know, there's also people who would argue that they can't really see anything that is different. You know, I think one of the first things that I would like to bring up this morning really is how inspiring is the speech, because aside the things that are read out, you know, there's people who will mention that this is not even a live speech, it's recorded, it's pre-recorded. And so aside, you know, the things that are mentioned in the speech, how inspiring really is the speech? When you see your president speak to you, you know, how many people look at those things or look at the last 30 minutes of the president speaking and say, yes, you know, I believe in Nigeria. I believe in the things that the president is saying, and I'm looking forward to, you know, the beauty and the things that he is promising. That's, you know, one angle. And, you know, he also made mention that Nigeria's unity is non-negotiable. There's, you know, many, many arguments about those things. We are going to be joined this morning by Mr. Opunabo Inkotarya. And of course, we'll be having a review of what President Muhammadu Buhari has, of course, spoken to Nigerians about this morning. Good morning. Thanks for joining us, sir.
Good morning, Jide Johnson.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to be with you, Anita. Good morning.
Morning, Jide Johnson.
Happy independence to you, to all Nigerians, both at home and in the diaspora.
All right.
It's the dawn of a new season.
Thanks for joining us. Of course, Opunabo Inkotarya will be joining us later, my mistake. Jide Johnson, I want to start with, you know, the thing that I was just mentioning, and that is really watching the last 30 minutes of the president speaking to Nigerians. Did you feel inspired? Do you think that, you know, a lot of Nigerians have looked at that and, you know, are excited about how far Nigeria has come in the last 6 years and where we might be headed?
All you need to do is for you to do the content analysis and a textual analysis of the president's speech, speeches, the one he made today, the one he made on June 12th, the one he made last year, and the series of speeches he has delivered, you just discover that they are the same. They are just recycled speech. I have directed to so and so. We have engaged. We are going to make. We are just promissory statements. No clear-cut policy direction. In those speeches, they are just for me, they are just rhetorics playing on words and intelligence of Nigeria. There is food scarcity. You talked about the price index of product going up. That's why that you have made economic gains in terms of growth, in terms of your GDP. And you can situate that, oh, that there are some middlemen that are trying to, that are responsible for that hoarding of food for their own personal gain. In a sense, you have directed, we keep hearing directive in those speeches. For me, so I was not inspired. That's one. Two, if you, I don't understand why our leaders would think that what we deserve is not limited to this particular president. That's been the practices, and I think it's something that started in the era of military regime. For them to address us through recorded speeches and not speeches that are delivered live to us where body tunes in. In the past, you know, we used to listen to these speeches in the night. This time around, we just sit down and record the speeches. That's why sometimes these speeches are not inspiring, because every Nigerian knows that, oh, these speeches are recorded, and so we can give it to you whenever you want it. So that's my take on that. And then you just look at what the president said concerning Twitter. We have engaged Twitter, a set of a presidential committee. We've engaged them, and then they will leave the ban. The president talked about the girl child. And I've asked many people, when you devote too much focus and attention on the girl child, what happens to the boy child? Who is going to marry the girl child in the future? Well, you know, all these glitches and all these buzzword and the rest of it. Every child is important, both girl and boy. If you train your girl child and you train and train your girl child and you leave the boy child alone, who is going to get married to? All you need to do is for you to take a sample of it. And I'll give you an example. I try to personalize things. And my son will be 20 next year. He's 19 plus. If you ask him about marriage, there's what he tells you that he's not interested in marriage. And he's not the only one. There are so many young boys out there. Go and ask them. You go and ask how many ladies out there. Because in the last 20, 25 years, you have been talking about the girl child. You left the boy child alone. For me, when people talk about that, it's just following the Western world. And the Western world are facing the problem. I listened to the House of Rep members talking about 70% of African-American fathers abandoning their home, leaving the home for the mothers alone. And as a result of that, that has created problem. Same thing with Hispanics. I think among the Hispanics, about 40%. Among the whites, about 30%. So basically, every child needs to be taken care of. Every child needs to be... But we don't have to be carried away by the Western ideology and Western ideas and bring it back home and we think it will work. And then the president said, oh, they have just realized that the civil service is very, very important and crucial to governance. In actual sense, they said, so they are going to make investment in that. Anyone that does not understand that now, that has been president in 1983 to 84, and is now saying that in 2021, does not seem to understand what governance is all about. There are some things which came out of that speeches and which created fear for me. When you talk about this food index and the rest of it, and then they're talking about the commodity board, they are going to... I remember that when we tell people that we used to queue to buy bread, used to queue to buy milk, we used to queue to buy essential commodities in 1983 and 1984. When I tell my son some certain, he said, that is not possible. That can never happen in Nigeria. Nigeria that is full of abundance. And sometimes, some of the speeches of the president tends to resonate with that particular, it recreates that particular period, that particular era. And those that are in my generation and above can relate with it. That is more or less like we're in the same cycle. So,
yeah.
For me...
So now you're here, Jide Johnson. I want you to continue with this, but what the president mentioned was that the artificial shortages and the increase in price of food are caused by middlemen who have, been hoarding products, and that's what, led to the increase in price of foodstuff across the country. And, he said it was going to set up the board.
He has directed the Ministry of Agriculture. He has directed security agents, Nigerian security agents, and then the National Assembly. And I ask this question, why are they elected and appointed in the first instance? That's the question you need to ask. Why do they need presidential directive to do their job? Why? Who are these middlemen? They are ghosts. They are not Nigerians. Where do they hold this food? The prices of commodity, I go to the market regularly. I'm a single parent. So I go to the market regularly. So I know what the price indexes are, what the commodity price indexes are. I know. I service my car, I service my gen, so I know the price index of commodities and goods in this country. So who are the middlemen? They are ghosts. If you have a Ministry of Agriculture and you have different agencies under Ministry of Agriculture, and if it's possible for people to hoard food, definitely, when it's possible for people to be kidnapped in this country and pay ransom, and for security agencies not to locate them, then it is easier to even hoard food. So that's just my take on it. The security agencies that have been overstretched in providing security will now also be given an assignment, okay, for them to hoard food. Now we close border. Now if our border is closed, where are they holding this food? Where are they taking them to? Because if our border is open, I will say, okay, people are engaged in illegal activities, probably exporting our food through illegal routes. But that does not occur in this particular instance. We should understand that we face these challenges. When a lot of farmers couldn't go to their farm, we have not seen anything yet. I'm not a prophet of doom. I just had an interaction with one of my students that operates a farm. He had over 600 acres of farm somewhere in Oyo State. And he said he has abandoned his farm yesterday. He told me that he's going back to Ibadan today, that some people want to sell their farms, that farmers are selling their farm. Nobody wants to go to the farm because they are not making anything out of the farm. If you are not careful, you are kidnapped and you use whatever you make from the farm to pay ransom. Even workers are not interested in going to the farm. So there are things that the president can live in Aso Rock, operate on his Olympian height, far away from reality, but lives based on the reports and the memo that his appointees are given to him. But the reality on ground does not match what the president is talking about. Because you could see, it's clear. What he needs to do is to leave Aso Rock and go to Yanya Market or go to any market in Abuja. Remove the paraphernalia of that office. And then they come to the reality of it. If the National Assembly can do its oversight function and the Ministry of Agriculture, with all his personnel, can't do it, it's the security agencies that will do it. And those middlemen, they are making life difficult. Those middlemen are working contrary to national issues. They are committing treason and felony. They should be arrested, and they should be tried, and they should be named.
All right, Jide Johnson. Jide Johnson, when the president began his speech, one of the first things he said was that the past 18 months have been some of the most difficult periods in the history of Nigeria. And since the Civil War, that he doubts whether Nigeria has ever been through a period of challenges because of the COVID-19 pandemic, as Nigeria did during the Civil War. I wasn't born at that time. So let's get your perspective, if the president's analogy and comparison is correct, that we're going through harder times now because of the COVID-19 pandemic, and that the presidency is going through more challenges than in the Civil War era. And maybe if we need to cut the president some slack.
Well, the pandemic brought its own attendant challenges. No doubt, you know, it caused a major disruption. A major disruption in the socio-political and economic life of our nation. Not only our nation, across the globe. So it did not affect Nigeria in isolation. The Civil War affected Nigeria alone as a nation. The pandemic is a global disruption. Now, how did we respond to it? I agree that it brought its own attendant challenges, but how did we respond to it? What steps, what measures did you put in place? So for the president to situate that with the civil war that happens between 67 and 1970, I think it's a wrong analogy as far as I'm concerned, because that civil war was dealt with by Nigerians. And I guess Nigerians did not even go through this type of hardship we are going through. Now it's pretty difficult for an average. I know what I'm talking about. It's pretty difficult for an average. If for those of us, for you that are in the studio, and for the viewers that are listening to us at home, they can tell you for a fact the kind of pressure you receive because you are working, because people see you that you are working, and the kind of pressure you receive when people are calling you for relief measures, for palliative and whatever. When someone will just call you, someone you know will just say, if only you can give me 5,000, if only you can give me, I just need 2,000. Just, you know, all those numerous calls you will receive on daily basis, and every Nigerian receives. But we don't have access to bogus allowances like the National Assembly, or allowances like the senators or political appointees who are entitled to, they get all of the allowances. If we face that challenge, what measures does the president do to reduce the cost of governance? What measure? Because if you look at the cost of governance in Nigeria, you discover that we have more money being spent on recurrent expenditure than capital expenditure. We are breaking every rule of productivity. When you spend more money, when you consume more and you produce less, the more you consume, the less you produce, and the more difficult it becomes for you. So what steps has the government taken in reducing the cost of governance, in managing the austerity measure? So for me, things are difficult, but not only difficult for Nigerians, it's affected every part of the world. But what measures do they put in place across the globe to deal with the issue? And what measures did we put in place to deal with the issue in Nigeria? Were we giving palliative? Those palliatives were ordered. Just like the president said, some people ordered food. And not a single person has been prosecuted for ordering the palliatives. Not a single person has been named and shamed for ordering the palliative. We lived with that as business as usual. We don't even know whether some of the palliatives are still in some warehouses rotting away, just like those ones that were discovered that brought about the beast in every Nigerian. And people don't understand that an hungry man is an angry man. People talk that Nigerians have animalistic tendency. All you need to do is just to look at video clips from Britain when they had issues of fuel shortages. And then you see that what usually happens when we have fuel shortages in Nigeria was created across Great Britain, where people you thought were gentlemen and ladies were throwing blows at the fuel station. So if you don't put in measures, you make people, you return people to self-help. And in self-help situation, the survival of the fittest. Right. So I don't think there's any measure. Yeah,
let me just also bring, maybe one or two other things. He's blamed middlemen. He's blamed COVID-19. He's also blamed certain financiers. You know, when he made mention of Nnamdi Kanu and Sunday Igboho, he said that, you know, these are, you know, persons who have tried to, break apart the country. They are secessionists, and current administration will deal decisively and take decisive actions against secessionist agitators, and said that Nnamdi Kanu and Sunday Igboho have financiers, some of which are in the National Assembly. I'm sure you may want to spread your thoughts into some of all these things, but the angle I want to look at is the fact that the government has taken no blame whatsoever for anything, either it's financiers or middlemen or it's COVID-19 or, you know, just anything that can be blamed. The government has gone ahead to blame them without taking any responsibility for any of these challenges.
You know, the foundation of any building determines the type of structure you're going to put on that building. When this administration came into power in 2015, it took the president more than 6 months to constitute his cabinet. And people said, oh, the president needs to pick the best set of people to, you know, it's not business as usual. He's trying to look for the best, to get this, to get that. And by the time the cabinet was constituted, it was even worse than business as usual, because it was made up of political class, people that I've been part of. So we lost 6 to 7 months setting the national economy on track. And that setback, this administration has not recovered from it. There are many programs I did concerning that, condemning that action, that the president should constitutionally was required to constitute his cabinet. He cannot run the presidency alone. It's the executive, and the executive is not complete without the cabinet. that what the president is doing is not constitutional. And we have seen that people have justified that when the former Osun State governor almost run, who happens to be the Minister of Interior now, almost run the state for almost 4 years without this commissioner. So that's where the blame game starts. When you don't, the first step to solving a problem is for you to realize and accept responsibility for whatever actions or inactions you have taken. All we have seen with this administration is to blame every other person. Now, if they are financiers or secessionists, no problem. Identify them. Name them. Prosecute them. Let Nigerians know, because you have the intelligence. Not the okay, there are National Assembly members that are financing secessionists. There are two ways you can look at it. One, you could call them secessionists. You could call them self-determination people, depending on whatever nomenclature you want to use. Just like we term banditry as, we term people that are terrorists as banditry, and we are slow at tagging them and labeling them as terrorists, but we are quick at labeling people that are calling for a self-determination, the right of self-determination, secessionist. If there are National Assembly members that are financing them, fantastic. The president should name them. But the president is slow to name those that are financing Boko Haram and those that are financing terrorists that even United Arab Emirates have named, have identified some that are sponsoring Boko Haram in Nigeria. I think they owe us the responsibility of giving us a truthful account of what happens. That's transparency in government. Name whoever is responsible. Let us know those that want to destroy the unity of this country. Let us know those that are causing chaos in this country. But let us not situate those that are calling for self, let us not term those that are calling for self-determination secessionist. If there's a right for self-determination as enshrined in United Nations Charter. A friend of mine did a short interview with me yesterday, and he asked me what are the gains that we have made as a country. I said, well, you know what? For us to be together as a nation for 61 years, that's a gain. That's the way I look at it, despite all the challenges that we have. That some nations have come into existence even after our own. They are no longer nations till now. They are no longer nations till now. And then what do we need to do? We need to identify those things that have united us, and then we need to understand, to identify those things and work on those things that have united us, and those things that want to disintegrate this nation. We need to identify those issues and deal with it. And when people are calling, when people are helpless and there is no hope in the system, in the nation, they believe that, okay, well, when we go back to your tent, O Israel, when we go back to our tent, our lives will be better. When you look at the structure of Nigeria, when you look at what is the hope for an average Nigerian, you see, we still have some measure. If they are talking about people on the street and people, when the governors themselves are divided, we have the Northern Governors Forum, we have the Southern Governors Forum. Where is that written? Where the governors cannot meet? The Nigerian Governors Forum, I'm not sure they have met. They have not met since the issue of 16 and 19. They have not met. They have not found yet. So you have the Northern Governors Forum are meeting, the Southern Governors Forum are meeting, and then you said you have a nation. A nation where you have the Attorney General talking about penal code, where you have the penal code in the north, and then you have the criminal code in the south. A nation where you have ISBA in Kano, and that can arrest anybody based on the way they dress, based on whatever they drink and they eat. And you just discover that there are things that we are doing that is causing division rather than promote unity. So it is not those that are agitating alone. It is even the political actors are promoting divisions in Nigeria more than those that are agitating for But what we have seen is blame. When you blame others, and you don't blame yourself, it shows that you are irresponsible. You are not ready. What is responsibility? Now, responsibility is the ability to respond. That's what it means. Ability to respond to situations and issues. Now, when you have that ability, but when you blame others, it means that you are disabled in responding to issues. And that's why we have a catalog of issues, and these issues keep to be a recurring feature across the nation.
Jide Johnson, thank you very much for your time that you've taken to analyze the president's speech this morning. Do have a great day and happy Independence Day.
Thank you very much, Anita. And once again, thank you, Osari. It's a pleasure to be with you guys this morning.
Absolutely. Happy Independence. Yes. Enjoy the public holidays. Yeah.